My son was singing the song this morning.
Yeah.
He's like, are you going to go record? Do, 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 do. I'm like, yes. Do, 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 do. Hi, my name's John Papa.
And I'm Craig Shoemaker.
And welcome back to Five Things. This week, we're going to talk about five things about service workers. Craig.
That's me.
Yes. Almost called the camera. Number one.
Number one.
What are service workers?
What are service workers? Well, they are a JavaScript proxy that works within the browser.
Okay.
And operates independent of the UI thread. So it gives you an opportunity to kind of deal with different fetch requests that go out from the browser.
That's it?
Well, I got more to say. In the next one, that's like the setup.
I know. Number two, why and when would I use these?
They're mostly used in the context of progressive web apps, and even in that, you'll often find them used in offline contexts. So the idea is that as you have a request that go out from the browser, you can intercept that and then return contents that you might have cached in the browser. As well as the technique of being able to keep data in sync between different tabs without an API like this is often very difficult. And so using Service Worker, you can achieve things like that. And also push notifications. So you have an ability to allow your web app to act a little bit more like a desktop application.
So if I had a set of data that I commonly use all over the place, and I don't have to hit the server every time.
Right.
Instead of just storing a local variable, which only works in my current tab.
Exactly.
Like maybe a list of states or countries.
Right.
Get those, cache them, then the service worker could say, don't make the network call, retrieve them.
Yes, exactly. And the nice thing about it is that there's restrictions about how the service worker stays alive so that you know for a fact that if you have multiple tabs open, you're only hitting that one version of the app.
Number three, what about the life cycle of this service worker? Like, how does it stay alive? How do you know when it's gone?
Well, the first thing that happens is when you hit a page that registers the service worker, it'll start installing the service worker. At that point, you enter into a phase where it kind of waits to get a response. So you could reach out and grab assets like images, CSS, JavaScript, and cache that in the browser. You could hit like an Azure function and get some compute happening and return data from there. But whatever is happening asynchronously, once it comes back, then you'll be able to set it up and it'll be active. And then it can take fetch requests from there. So like I know on your website, you've set it up so that any image that's requested returns your headshot.
That's how we're doing this.
Yeah, that's it.
So what if I want to expire the service worker? Like, how do I make sure there's a new version of it coming across?
Well, what you do is you give it a new key, and then you need to make sure that all the browser tabs are closed, or you exit Chrome, or you completely navigate away from the application. And then once you come back to it, and it looks at the new key that comes in, then you can install a new version of the service worker.
Okay. Sweet. Number four, what kind of restrictions does the service worker put on my app?
Well, the first one is that it always needs to run through SSL. And that's a really good thing because you can imagine that with the type of power that's available here, you don't want anyone getting in the middle and getting up in your business. The only difference, the only exception to that is for localhost. So when you're developing on your local machine, you don't have to worry about having a local SSL client set up there. So that's the first part of it. The next part is the second time around is really when you're going to see the service worker. So the first time you hit a page that registers a service worker, it's uncontrolled by the worker. So you need to navigate away or go back to it in some other way, and that's when the service worker comes alive at that point. There's all
comes alive.
Comes alive. And just like the name hints at, it's a worker. So it exists in a context that's away from the UI thread, and so you don't have direct access to the DOM. So just like you would do with a web worker, you're going to post and receive messages between the two different items.
How can I make sure I set it up right?
One of the best ways is you can install Lighthouse, which is a browser extension that'll go through and analyze your service worker for a lot of different aspects of really a progressive web app.
Okay.
But it'll hit much of what it has to do with service workers, and you can read the reports and deal with it from there.
That's nice.
Yeah.
Number five, what about browser support?
Browser support is actually pretty good, even though it's a relatively new API. So all of your modern browsers are going to include support for it. If you go to caniuse.com, global support is reported at about 75%. So it's not the type of thing where we're going to take for granted that everybody has it, but the name of the game here really is progressive web apps. As long as your app works without using the service worker, that's a really good start. And then people can opt in to say maybe they want to take your application offline, maybe they want to opt in to push notifications. Depending on how you set up, it can work really well.
All right, thank you.
Cool, thank you.
My name is John Papa.
And I'm Craig Shoemaker.
And we just learned five things about service workers. Mm-hmm.
He's got the goatee thing going on right now,
yeah.
Right?
Oh, is he?
Yeah. Which I haven't seen him with one of those before.
Yeah.
He's trying to do the beard because he seriously gets self-conscious about looking like me.
So, really?
Sorry. We did a talk together. He put a wig on just so people would see the difference.